This is the theorem. So for any quasi-stable pre-sheaf with Fermi transfers, that is a one invariant. And there is key cohomologies too, and moreover, they can say. And let me note that.
Andrei, sorry, I'm transitive on top.
Yes. Just one. Sorry, what you said?
And transitive.
Oh, yes, yes. Sorry, thanks. Yes, transitive. At the same. Yes. Yes. Okay. Yes. And let me just note that sheafications are automatically additive, but the additivity for the pre-sheaf is not a sheaf property. Okay. In this statement, let me note at the beginning that these cases are equivalent. And both imply the last equality. And in the talk in the proof, we are proving the first equivalence. And we use the standard argument to deduce the second one and to deduce the third. So we can say that the theorem is the first equality and others are presented for completeness of the statement. Well, I should say what are transfers and Fermi transfers. And this is a structure to be a pre-sheaf on a category of correspondences. I think that participants are familiar probably with many of things which I'm going to start with. And you're welcome to ask me to skip something. So this is slide for core correspondences and Fermi correspondences. And we can say that core correspondences is group associated with the groupoid that elements are given by morphisms from schema X to the symmetric power of Y. And so these are so multivalued maps. And for Fermi correspondences by Vygotsky-Smirnov, this are Nisnevich sheaf morphisms between two models of infinite sphere, relative sphere over X and Y. At the left side, the model is given by projective space, projective line in this point at infinity, and its mesh power. And at the right side, it is quotient space of affine line and complement to zero. This property implies that in SH, in Marilyovsky stable homotopy category, is equipped canonically with transfers, with Fermi transfers, and it can be written that SH of, in fact, for an arbitrary base is equivalent to SH of K, SH frame of P. So this allows to work with the right, this category SH like this TM. And this is the basic principle. Oh, yes. And here is a picture which illustrates the notion of core correspondences and Fermi correspondences. We can say that supports in both cases are finite, and there is some additional structure which is called framing for the Fermi correspondences. And now let me say what is the stoichiometric invariance. So the theorem said, let me recall, that any pre-sheaf which have such structure of transfers that is relative and a one invariant, and this structure should satisfy also the property that is called quasi-stability, then it is strictly a one invariant. random entropy invariant. The strict homotopy invariance of a sheaf of Abelian groups equivalently means that one term complex is a one invariant in the derived category of sheaves. Lindbergh-McLean, the homotopy category of such spectra with respect to Nisnevich local equivalences. And converse is true in the following sense.
I have missed the beginning of the talk, but I would like to be sure that you mean what I mean and what I expect strict invariance to be. So this is A1 invariance of higher homotopy groups of this sheaf with respect to Nisnevich topology, right?
I started this phrase just about sheaves of Abelian groups. And this means that cohomologies are A1 invariant, and this is what is in the theorem. And here
that I want to distinguish between strong homotopy invariance and strict homotopy invariance. Morel has this notion of strong, and this means just the zero homotopy and first homotopy. And this means strict homotopy means all homotopy, right?
Yes, in fact, we will work every time with Swan's stable case, and we will have and we will say about strict homotopy invariance for always for sheaves of Abelian groups.
Do you use the result of Morel that for sheaves of Abelian groups?
It's just recurrent. I said that I'm starting with some recollection of notions and facts and explanation why this theorem is interesting. What does it mean in the context of other results? And here is a setting of results about strict homotopy invariance, and we can say that this property is equivalent to be a one invariant in this homotopy category of spectra with respect to Nisnevich local equivalences. Any A1 invariant object have strict homotopy invariant homotopy sheaves. And another form of this statement is that heart of the category, this is just a notation for the subcategory of A1. This is notation for this subcategory. And its heart is the category of strict invariant Nisnevich sheaves. And the statement in the first form is improved by Ivanov and Rich Fine. If I cite correctly, in short form, it can be said that any abstract cohomology theory over K has strict homotopy invariant associated Nisnevich sheaves with the pre-sheaves which define cohomology theory. And abstract means that it is some pre-sheaf on category of pairs equipped with the differentials and satisfy certain set of axioms, including A1 invariants and long exact sequences. So again, combination of A1 invariants and topological property leads to the strict homotopy invariance. Let me indicate again that first row are by definition and others are theorems. And there are some proofs and some history. The first proof by Morel was for the case of perfect field K. And in fact, geometrical rule of the use of perfectness in the proofs is almost always or always the fact that generic points of reduced schemas are smooth. And this was needed to make such an induction procedure, and usually it is used for some induction procedures with respect to codimension. in the proof of the statement, it is needed to show that, let me write in such form. Let me use such notation. Let me write E as was on the previous slide. For a local schema and enough for local Mendelian. So this is looks like I mean just E. And we can say that this notation in other terms would mean that this is cohomology with the support if it would be pre-sheaf of in Bergmann-Hodling spectrum of the sheaf of hybrid groups. And extension, so the forgetting of the support. This map should be zero. And to prove this, it was used this such an induction procedure. And for each step, it was used that we can say locally because this point is smooth. This quotient space of X local schema quotient by complement to the local schema is Tom space for. In the power, which is codimension of Z in X. And by this, for this space, it was used the gamotopy, which moved zero section into non-zero. And this is the contracting gamotopy, we can say. And or we can say canonical morphism from affine line from Z cross affine line. Affine space in this codimension is trivial. And later, so I think that it is joint years in the middle of zero. Approximately. There was a proof for non-perfect case. It was based on the Gabbard presentation lemma. And the argument is that we can send an arbitrary local schema, this called a subscheme, into the relative affine line, we can say relative projective line, over some another local scheme in such way that Z maps isomorphically on the image and the image is finite over V. And by this, we can change the left quotient space to the right quotient space and in the quotient space, there is a moving. And Gabbard's presentation lemma, at least in published sources that time was presented only for infields and for infinite fields and it covers the general case of an arbitrary field. Okay, what about...
I did not understand. I am interested in the last statement that you made about Gabbard presentation. I'm sorry, I did not understand. Do you agree that it holds in over arbitrary field now with the recent results?
Yes. I think that it is... correct. And the second strategy now is strategy for general case for any field with the use of Gabbard's presentation lemma. Okay, what about transfers, trigonometric invariance for pre-sheaves with transfers? Let me cite the statements that again. In another terms, it means that gamma-top invariant pre-sheaf with transfers have strictly gamma-top invariant associated Schneeville sheaf and the risk as well. And this for core correspondences, it is the classical theorem by Vygotsky, which was in the beginning of the study of motivic categories and category M. And it appeared in yes, if I write the year correctly in the article of this year, or at least approximately, it is in the second half of 19th. And we can say that this theorem, it follows that Nisnevich, that Nisnevich sheaves associated with motivic cohomologies represented by an arbitrary smooth scheme are strict A1 gamma 2 invariant. And Marais' proof in several years generalized this fact for stable gamma 2 groups. And you see that for any field, while this reasoning is for perfect field, and I didn't mention this. It seems to me that I wrote this, but it disappeared. The field K is perfect these theorems. And in years later again, I mean 10 years now after Marais' proof, and during several years, it was, we can say the fact about stable gamma 2p groups, P1 stable gamma 2p groups, and the strict gamma 2p invariants was recovered by transfer technique, because framed transfers version of the theorem was proven by Garpush and Panin with some set of assumptions, which I will discuss later on the base field. And if I say correctly, this is preprint appeared this year. So post-graduation of mixed preprints and articles, but I remember, it is easy for me to remember the year of the preprint. And later, thanks. Possibly.
Across Druzhinin Panin, why do you write a characteristic is zero? Isn't it so?
Oh, I think that this slide was just wrong. I think that I already corrected this typosis. I inserted already perfectness, and I changed it zero by two. Sorry, please. Yes, and thank you very much that you mentioned. I hope that this is correct slide. Okay. Compliments for characteristic zero and finite fields case, I will say about this for any perfect field. And as I said, that it recovered result for stable gamma 2p groups, but it is not the main aim of this approach. Let me indicate. Oh, yes, I see. There is just a correct slide, the next one, but the wrong slide wasn't there again. Now let me say the results, which are consequences of this for about hearts. And if I correct with this information, so the heart for category M was described in degree statistics. It is not the main result, but it appeared in his work. And I think that hard for effective motives, it probably appeared already in Vygotsky's works, and it follows immediately from Rostig motives. And similar descriptions hold for framed case. And it is, So I'm not sure that synonyms, the owners of the synonyms which I wrote would want to be written here. I don't know, because these are not the main results of the works, but these facts appeared implicitly in Ananievsky initiative article, and such formulations, and these appeared in Bachmann and Bachmann-Jakerson articles. And I seen it in Mintzfeld article where he's sitting with reference to Bachmann. Now we can say that this recovered the description for the heart of the stable P1 stable gamma 2p category by the use of strict gamma 2p invariance theorem and by the use of this, we can say, reconstruction equivalence. In weak form, I mean in naive form. basically by Voivodsky's lemma. And the right side, which is blue, it scaled homotopy modulus, and it was known due to Marin earlier from the same works which was discussed before. And yes, these were results for perfect fields, and by proof of the stereomotive invariance, these results are proven for non-perfect fields. Now, let me explain what is the difference between, you can say, Morel's stereomotive invariance theorem or stereomotive invariance on stable homotopy groups and for Plesiewski's transfers. We can say that the first one gives a criterion of A1 invariance in the homotopy category of S1 spectra with respect to Nishnevich local equivalences to be, as we said already before, A1 invariant, it is equivalent to have stereomotopy invariant homotopy groups. And the transfers approach is oriented on the computation or construction of an object which is A1 invariant, which is motivically local. A1 invariant object in this category, it is exactly motivically local object. And it computes the functor of the localization functor. The above results about the stereomotopy invariance of homotopy groups and hearts of the categories are consequences, but the main, the central is the computation of the stable homotopy localization, stable motivic homotopy localization. Let me show that the theorem which is wrote, which is written at the bottom is equivalent to the strict homotopy invariance theorem for Plesiewski's transfers up to ELSO1 theorem, which holds for any base. Namely, it is the statement that Nishnevich localization without transfers, the usual one, and Nishnevich localization with transfers on the category of objects with transfers is the same. This equality is written where forgetful functor is skipped. Okay, we can say that this is a S1 spectra form of the stereomotopy invariance theorem up to this fact about the Nishnevich localization, which is correct for any base and proven originally for any base. In ELSO1 form, with the use of ELSO1 result, which is called additivity or S1 cancellation, and which is again proven originally for in Garkushapani's article, the argument holds for any base. So up to two properties which hold for any base, the stereomotopy invariance theorem is equivalent to the motivic locality of framed motifs. So we can say that this formula computes the motif of a schema in A1 Nishnevich localization of the category of S1 spectra with framed transfers, we would say, of A1 invariant Nishnevich local objects that are equipped with framed transfer structure in the commutative category of S1 spectra Plesiewski. And so we can say that up to the right two side facts, it is again equivalent to the stereomotopy invariance. Now, let me mention the cancellation and let me not spend time with it and say that the central result of the theory is the computation of the fibrant replacement within stable motivic model structure, and it is presented here. The equivalences of these arrows are, in fact, this is what provides the mentioned on the first slide at the beginning, which we discussed equivalence. So this equivalence at the right bottom corner is provided by it's provided by motivic equivalences here. And infinity categorical construction, there is another proof by Marc Ayoa with the use of the localization theorem. And let me mention that formally, the equivalence for infinity categories is, at least formally, it is a little bit, in some sense, it is stronger. It is stronger in the sense that it says that not only any object diagram of infinite size, so everything can be equipped with Feynman transfers, but in, at the same time, this property follows by these two equivalences as well. And it can be said that it is an alternative argument to prove the equivalence in the infinity categorical set. So consequences of, and yes, and the complicated part of this theorem, this we can say that this part didn't use it notion, and it was this stable motivic equivalences were proven for any base originally, or at least for finite dimension on Nilsson separated basis, yes. With the use of Voevodsky's lemma, which is proven for any base in the appendix for the article by Manta Ayoa Khan and Cessna Leterson. And with the use of Voevodsky's lemma, then by model category theory arguments, the equivalence is added to it. But the frequency of the right sides, it uses the full set of results of the theory mentioned before, stereogrammatic invariance, additivity, property of insinuation localization, cancellation, and corner theorem. What I said before, let me indicate that the first equivalence follows just by the Voevodsky's lemma, and the second one uses the corner theorem. But it is proven now already for an arbitrary base too. And the consequences are that geometry groups and cohomologies can be computed by geometry groups and cohomologies of Feynman transfers, S1 spectrum of Feynman transfers complex. I mean for local essentialism view. So I finished now this introduction about, I started with trigonometric invariance property, and I said then what are main results, what is it, okay, not main results, but what is the central main result in the, and the generality of these results is perfect base field case because of trigonometric invariance theorem. Let me mention that all the assumptions in this theory on the base field appeared because of the trigonometric invariance, which were consequently eliminated. Yes, this is again the slide which recalls at the moment what before. Proof for an arbitrary field, which cases were known. As was mentioned already, it was known that Nisnevich and Zariski cases are equivalent, and implication from the Nisnevich to Zariski, it is contained in Suslin's talk about the case of inverted Hellen. Last equivalence in this three column three equivalences is contained in the same talk too, and I should say that this he proved the first one, and we use the standard arguments to the Zariski and the Zariski case. We don't use implication from the Zariski to Nisnevich case because, in fact, no one is not easier. When we prove the Nisnevich case, we can assume that the schema, we can say that schema X is local Ginzelian, but we need to compute Nisnevich cohomologies. In the Zariski case, we can compute Zariski cohomologies, but we need to assume that schema is local. And in the argument we use that the schema is local Gaussian, it is easier for us, and it is easy, in fact, to prove the first one, at least with this argument at the period.
What do you mean? Yes. You mean the base is local Gaussian? What is local Gaussian?
Oh, I'm sorry. I killed by the word base schema X here. Sorry. Yes, I say that X can be assumed local Gaussian or local results, and we work with local Gaussian schema. This is the first equivalence for local Gaussian schemes, and we essentially state cases of this equivalence of the first one, which were known. It is the case of L equals zero, the case of everything which is base change from the perfect base field. I mean any F which is base change of a presheaf of a perfect base field. It follows from the perfect base field case. And for core correspondences case, the result was obtained by Suslin with coefficients where P is inverted. For framed case, the claim is true too, but I don't know no one, at least published source, where it is written and proven. Okay, let me say non-published, but presented on my home page, lecture notes. I will say some details later. Here is a slide about the proof of the stereometric invariance theorem for presheaves with framed transfers. And we can say that this applies up to some possible, but not big modifications to original core correspondences case. We can say in both cases that the proof consists of two parts. It is needed to prove some set of results, some properties of gamma-top invariant, which is the transfers. And this part depends on the type of transfers. Seriously, these are more elementary properties, such as injectivity and the risk excision theorems. And each time it is needed to construct certain gamma-topy in the category of correspondences. And clearly it depends on the category of correspondences. And in original Vygotsky's proof, this part didn't require any assumption on the base field. And now we can say that it do not require any assumption on the base field too for framed correspondences. Now, I mean, after some completions original Garkusha-Panin's article, where it was assumed because of some of these statements that characteristic is known to and infinite. And what we use.
What are the assumptions? What are the assumptions on F? F is homotopy invariant. Yes, just a moment.
F is gamma-top invariant, presheaf, radiative, quasi-stable framed presheaf.
But you say that it depends on the type of transfers. So you don't assume that it has frame transfers only, but also you can.
This theorem was proven after Vygotsky's proof for core correspondences. It was proven, I think, by Walker for K not correspondences, if I sitting correctly. And this result is contained and proven for more general setting in. You can say for K correspondences in particular, in another Garkusha-Panin's work. And I mean it that each time when you change the category of correspondences, you need to find a construction of all the required moving gametopias, so proof of moving lemmas, construction of gametopias in the category of correspondences for the type of correspondences which you work with. I had done this by myself too for quadratic width correspondences. And the most general case, it is the case of Fermat transfers. So these facts proven for Fermat transfers imply all other cases. And this part of the proof was changed during the years for basically generalized for, and finally the case of Fermat correspondences was covered. The proofs at the same time are different. In some works, you can see that proofs of these theorems for different types of transfers are different. Let me stress what we use today. It is the injectivity on local essentially smooth schemes and the risk excision. And yes, in this article, it is written that field is an arbitrary now, and the original part of the statement, surjectivity part, and it is written that injectivity part holds for any field too, so it is good for us, we can just refer to the statement as it is formulated. And injectivity, yes, it is proven originally in this article without any assumptions on the base field. And these are two theorems which we use. Others are formally non-needed for us. I was wrong with location of this. just a moment. It is this. And sorry, we use this. We use italic excision and we use injectivity on local. We use two facts about local essentialism schemes, injectivity and italic excision. We don't use.
What does it mean, excision on local? What do you mean by italic excision on local schemes? What does it mean?
I mean that for any Nisnevich square over such scheme. Yes, but for some reason it is called italic excision. Being honest,
I know the reason why it is called italic.
I had such
italic
question.
Excision. I know the reason why it's called italic.
So possibly it is good to. It would be good. Yes, when I
because historically.
Oh, you can say.
Okay. With isomorphic residue fields or isomorphic. You take neighborhoods of a point, so covers with isomorphic residue fields were often called ital neighborhoods. But I think if we distinguish ital topology from Nisnevich topology at all, then ital topology corresponds to covers which allow separable extensions of residue fields. So I would say it is better to call it Nisnevich excision. That makes perfect sense.
I agree.
Because
yes.
You don't consider ital cohomology. Am I right? That you don't consider.
Yes, we don't consider ital covers and ital cohomology. Mm-hmm. We only consider Nisnevich squares. So you're absolutely right. It is excision for Nisnevich topology, and it is called ital excision.
But it's just traditional terminology, Andrei.
I think it is important because when I hear ital excision, I start thinking about ital cohomology, but here it's not ital cohomology.
Yes, but at the same time, it is not easy how to formulate some excision property for some entire covering, which is not Misnevich excision property. The excision property, it is property for complete decomposable topologies, and entire topology is not completely decomposable. So it is even strange to pronounce this for entire topology, I think. And then we say that in the present article, in the stock, we discuss the proof, which changes the second part of the argument, which deduces the trivium of the invariance from the injectivity and excision properties. And let me say that this part of the argument wasn't changed before. In all the previous works, it was the strategy was like in the Vygotsky's proof. In Vygotsky's article, at the same time, the argument was written for the risky topology case, and for Misnevich topology case, it was written that it is similar. There is some formal difference when you consider some families of neighborhoods in these reasonings. You need to understand how to correct a generalized because notations and these notations are easier for the risky case. And at least in trigonometric invariance theorems, for quasi-stable frame at pre-shifts, it is radiative pre-shifts. It is written for Misnevich case with all details, and on opposite side, this article ignores the risky topology case. I illustrated this part of the argument by this picture, and this part of the argument assumes perfectness. Why? This picture illustrates such kind of argument. Consider, let's say, Canavus spectral sequences for schema X and X cross affine line. Or in fact, we can say that we consider Cousin complexes. And we need to prove that cohomologies are equal. And in fact, we prove that these complexes are equal, and simultaneously in some hidden form, we prove that these complexes compute the cohomologies. We can say that this proof is argument simultaneously proves, makes the essential arguments to prove the exactness of the Cousin complexes on local schemas. Formally, it is proven later with the use of trigonometric invariance, but in fact, the consideration of Cousin complex implicit is contained here. It is not formulated in such work, so the formula which you see here, it is not contained in the proof. It is just an illustration, interpretation of what is going. In fact, it is very accurate induction argument which deals each time with certain concrete classes in each time in certain concrete cohomology group. And we can say that morally, it is like comparison of Cousin complexes or Canavus spectral sequences if we do not use that Cousin complexes like that. And what is the reason why perfectness use it? To compare the terms of this complex and to say that there is an equivalence. And yes, F here means not necessary. In the reasoning, F can be also Misnevich localization of F. It can be some different modifications of the symbol F means something universal, not necessarily the original pre-sheaf. It can be changed in this argument. And to compare these two terms, if it would be originally F, we could apply Evan invariance, but for Elnice, we cannot. And maybe it's better to write here everywhere Elnice, because in this case, this complexes compute cohomologies in this Misnevich topology, and at least a priori. And again, perfectness is used to replace these quotient spaces by Thom spaces. Like like in the argument which was discussed before by Morel for connectivity, the aim, so the reason why PFMS is used, what it provides, it is the same. But let me indicate that aims are different nevertheless. That time it was needed to prove the inductivity theorem. Here it is needed to prove, to compare such Cousin complexes. And also, let me indicate that this proof by Vygotsky kind of arguments were used in other works and possibly even before. I mean the arguments which assumed perfectness before because of this reason. And now when we replace it, this by Tom spaces, we can induction step. It decreases the dimension of the schema. Now we work with this schema. Oh, I'm sorry, I think I wrote something. I think something is wrong. Sorry. Yes, it should be support. It should be not the schema. It should be the support here. And now a fine line over field case. Or we could say the argument that we reduce it to a schema of smaller dimension. And if we go in this argument by induction to the limit, we will see that here is a, in fact, a point. And we can apply these results for pre-sheaves on restricted on affine line over field. And we can compute Nisinovich cohomologies by these results and conclude that there is an equality. So this equivalence is provided by this fact. Okay, this was needed to make the induction step to decrease the dimension of the schema. Sorry, how many time I have? Let me understand what I should say to explain, to spend the time to explain the proof, because all of this was introduction.
Around an hour.
Sorry. It means that in fact it is already over time or not? It's 1 hour or 2 hours? I forget.
No, 2 hours.
Oh, 2 hours. Oh, okay. So I spent 1 hour and I have an hour to. Very, very good. Thank you. Okay. Yes. Is this what I should say about this? This is one statement which I should say about, because this statement is used in the proof. It is this lemma which allows to deduce results for finite fields from the results for infinite fields. And let me, so possibly there are other references, and this first time such lemma was in the archived version, in the unpublished version for Kone theorem for affine smooth pairs, where it is assumed in the proof that fit is infinite, and then it was deduced for finite field spaces argument. And later it was generalized and moved into the separate article, our article with Killian, to prove the trigonometric invariance theorem for finite fields. At the same time, let me note that it is indicated in remark of our text that the statement which assumed originally here perfectness or infiniteness can be proven directly by another argument. So it is not necessary to use this general reductive principle of finite field base field case result about Perchiefs transfers to infinite case. Another reference, it is and yes, we can say that results for Fermat motives were proven independently at the same time for in the context of infinity categorical correspondences by a similar argument. And the formal use of infinity categorical Fermat responses allows to formulate result in such categorical form that such a factor is conservative. And this simplifies this deduction or reduction argument, because we can use the statement in the final form. And moreover, this is true for, we can say, subcategories of one invariant precise. Not necessary, it's not needed to consider group complete so precise of let me write this one spectra, but in fact it can be formulated for group complete precise instead of S1 spectra. So it is not needed to make any initialization if we consider affine smooth schemas, at least. And possible, and I think that in fact in general, in fact for any smooth, for all smooth schemas, this is conservative. And this allows to deduce results about a one invariant precise of S1 spectra over finite fields from the case of infinite fields. Directly without mentioning the inner arguments of the strict moment of invariance. So we can say that this argument is formally shorter because it just takes the final statement and deduces the statement in the final form. But in our proof, we applied this lemma proposition to deduce each related some general statement about such type results that if some moving lemma about some diagram holds for infinite fields, then it holds for finite fields. And this is technically more complicated, independent from the second part. And in fact, this is the reason, let me indicate, in the new paper, this proposition is included in the appendix with the proof. It is short statement and there is a short proof because this article is not published. And the reason why it is not published is that this article ignores the second part of the reasoning at all. And it is written that it is not, it is a completion for the Garbuzhe-Panin's article. And it wasn't accepted that we referred to so complicated and serious statements, just saying that this part is true for any perfect field. And it was written for us that we asked the reader to prove by himself numerous results of Garbuzhe-Panin's article. But actually, this relates only to this part, which is it holds for perfect fields because it holds this as a strategy holds for perfect fields in Vygotsky's article. That's why we copy the proof of this statement and use it separately without formal reference. And yes, we prefer to use this and not to use the categorical form to be more elementary and to keep the reasoning consistent of usual category of additive linear frame transformations. And let me indicate that also this article has contained additional statements for Nisnevich proof of this isomorphism. Possibly I need to make it being bigger. And again, without it was written the same applies, that the same applies, the same problem applies to this part of the article, because we don't repeat the statements which do not assume that characteristic is zero, and we only prove the statements which assume that this characteristic is zero. And we assume nevertheless in this generalization that field is perfect and perfect. Nevertheless, for this statement, the perfect case implies the general case by the base change argument. And moreover, in another preprint on archive, I had wrote a general argument for the statement for an arbitrary field. So we can say that, in fact, the proof of this theorem now holds for any field too, and via direct geometrical arguments over an arbitrary field. But this part is not submitted, is not published, and I will not discuss the arguments today. Okay. This is a short slide about inverting of characteristic coefficient. So coefficient is inverted characteristic. Suslin proved quasi-isomorphism in of motivic complexes with inverted characteristic for inseparable extensions. I often doubt, is it correct to call extension by S inseparable or non-separable? I think inseparable, purely inseparable extension. And the argument is a trace argument, we can say, for it's enough to consider this case. It's needed to show, yes, here it is written the statement for Fremont correspondences setting, that there is a Fremont correspondence from lower point into the upper point and some coefficient such that this composition, I forget to include the projection, sorry. Is P epsilon. And in core correspondences case, it's even easier. It didn't require, the homotopies, and it was directly P, not P epsilon. And in Fremont correspondences, it uses a one gamma topies and also gamma topies to prove P, not P epsilon case. In categorical form, this statement about the isomorphism of motivic complexes means the fully faithful embedding of these categories. And moreover, we could write this for, again, for derived categories of pre-sheaves, of Abelian groups, and after inversion of one equivalences. And that's why you see that any result about a one invariant pre-sheaves for finite fields or for non-perfect field follows from the result for perfect field, which is limit of inseparable extensions. And formally, it is not needed to use such a categorical form of the statement. It just follows directly from such form of the statement. And the closest reference which I can mention for the Fremont transverse case, it is article by Elimander Khan. Formally, it discusses another theorem and another state. Namely, it is the statement in the abstract and in the introduction, this equivalence. And moreover, it is proven by this equivalence. And this allowed to deduce, we can say, reconstruction results and recognition as detailed in article by five authors. This recognition, okay, that this category is this category. And it was proven for any field after inverting of characteristic by this this point, which connects, we can say this statement repeating with this theorem for frame and context and this theorem. So both have this common consequence, but formally the results are independent because at least formally, here it is only fully faithful embedding. Yes, it is essential. This is equivalence of categories, it is stronger. And here, this and this are motivic equivalences by the formulation, but to deduce the formula for the framed motif, to deduce the formula for the stable motivic localization functor and the fiber replacement, you need to prove at least Nisnevich local equivalence. Or even schema-wise simplicial equivalence. And formally doesn't follow from motivic equivalence statement. You will need to have a single equivalent pair, not equivalence of categories, but equivalent pair, which defines some equivalence. So you need to use some other properties of the functors in the adjunction to deduce the claim. And let me not comment how is it easy or complicated to check these properties, but let me say that if I understand correctly, in fact, the argument which is written in the Umata Khan article can be applied to prove the Strigomatov invariance. Yes, not deduce it from the theorem which is formulated, but to take inner arguments, because inner arguments looks being again the transfer argument, trace argument for inseparable extension, but with the use of infinity category of tangentially framed correspondences. So this is different statement, different lemma with different proof, but it plays similar role. Sometime it was surprising for me. I thought that it is completely different proof because in the introduction of this article is there is no comments about the connection with this result at all. And I saw that this kind of arguments, because in the abstract it is formulated with this, that these are completely different arguments which allow to get results for inverting of characteristic statements. I don't know why the claim, this other results of theory of framed motifs are not included, only this. Why this formula of the stable motif localization is not included in the article, I don't know. It seems to me that there is no mathematical reasons. Okay, possibly the reason is that they wanted to avoid potential conflicts because this was an answer. I mean the formula for the framed motif with inverted characteristic. And let me stress again that this the formula does not apply the categorical equivalence. So the categorical equivalence requires, so the equivalence, not only fully faithfulness, but the equivalence requires other arguments, except this trace argument, which is discussed. I spent a long time with discussion of this, but we don't use this case and we don't make a reduction. And this proof for inverted heuristic was based on the proof for perfect fields. We don't use anything other from the results which were used in the perfect field in case except the injectivity and excision as mentioned before. Now, what is our proof? What is the strategy? What is the instrument? It is of compactifications. We work with compactified schemas, with compactified morphisms and compactified correspondences. Let me say that the use of compactifications, it is standard, it is common feature and classical feature of the geometric arguments in questions about K theory and in context of motivic geometric theory. For example, Quinn and Strick that use compactification. So on the technical level, we can say that compactifications appear in the study and take apart all time because, for example, for core correspondences and for framed correspondences, why we need to work with compactifications to construct framed correspondence. we need to get a finite morphism. Finite is projective. And to prove that some constructed morphism is finite, it is constructed by as a closed subscheme in some schema. And to prove that it is finite and projective, it is needed to make a closed embedding into a projective schema. And to count dimension to say that it is quasi-finite and projective. And that's why there are a lot of, the classical text by Vygotsky contained some standard type of diagrams with certain name to construct core correspondences. There is a instrument of nice triplets by Ivan Panin, which was used in, we can say, for several questions. And all this is something which is based on consideration of complexifications. What is difference here? Do we mean that we use complexifications? And this provide us more details. Is that we consider complexified morphisms in complexified objects. We consider complexification of the framed correspondence in the scenes that it is defined on the complexification of the schema as well. And yes, of course, we constructed by constructing certain, firstly, projective schema over such a complexified subscheme in it, and we control the behavior on this boundary, component of the boundary, and we show that morphism is finite. I mean, the intersection of this closed subschema with affine part, which is complement to the boundary, is finite. It is proven by the control of data, we can say sections of line bundles, which define this closed subscheme on this component of the boundary, and also we control this part of the boundary. In detail, we use two cases. So the role of this, why we need to consider this part of the boundary to construct compactified homotopies, which mean the correspondence from the compactified interval projective line, this boundary being by infinity. And another case which we consider it is
Andrei, you have switched to some different notation. First, what do you mean by compactified frame correspondences? And second, what is U on the bottom?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I think that it is not, it is hidden because, yes, U on the bottom, it is local essentially smooth schema. And in fact, it is essentially only that it's local. So it can be any local schema. And we can say compactified framed correspondence. I will say about this a little bit later. From such a compactified interval, and from local schema where boundary it is some smooth divisor. And is this defined classical correspondence? From the complement, from U, D, we have a classical correspondence into the target, into the codomain. And the role of the boundary, and we control the behavior of the data, and we use the behavior of the data on the over this closed point to control the properties over the complement. And what are compactified framed correspondences? I'm sorry. In fact, I didn't include the definition in the text or in the slides. I didn't include it because it is at the moment some temporal technical definition. It is some data which extends original framed correspondences to define some diagram, which involves now complexification of domain and codomain, but it is not, there is no definition construction of the category of such correspondences in the article at the moment. And That's why, in fact, I didn't present it as a definition. It is really, in the printed text, it is really a technical definition. I think it can be used to define some category, but to make, okay, we have in some process, some category of compactified ceramic responses to make a theory for a compactified object, but it is different. So in the proof, it plays a role as a technical tool. And in short, it is, what is this technical tool? It is classical framework correspondence. And the support, the main, what is needed is the compactification of the support. Maybe I skipped some also details, but basically it is a pair. It is appropriate compactification of the support and framework correspondence or between the complements to the boundary. So framing of the complement to the boundary. This and, is what we
Andrei, could you please write, because you use compactified framed correspondences systematically in your proof. Just give a definition. What a compactified framed correspondence from U to Y. Because otherwise,
and yes, I'm sorry, but yes, it will be better and quicker if I open this place, because as I said, it is technical. So just a moment. Oh, sorry.
But you can't write it on your slides. Is it so hard? Is it so difficult definition?
I think it, so. It is. It contains the so the framed correspondence. I even didn't wrote what a framed correspondence is. And I think that. It will be better if I just show the set detect in the text. I'm sorry, I understand that it is not good that I didn't include it, but okay, let me show in the possibly old version of the text, but I think that it is, it will be okay. This is, yes, so this is, yes, now you see everything what is needed. This is three definitions. So it is just, so what we use is this notion. It is held even not as a compactified frame. Now you see the definition 7.2, story again, and let me continue. This is called a focused compactified d-dimensional eta-framed correspondence. What does this mean? Firstly, let me explain the points of the definition. First point, it is a compactification of the support of the correspondence. Second point is a framing of the complement of the support to the boundary. And the third, it is a just an isomorphism between the support of this framework correspondence and the complement to the boundary. So the third point is was already pronounced by Wirtz. So we can say that this is support and correspondence and framing. Yes.
Here you have a local one-dimensional base, right?
Yes, yes, yes. Here it is written for local one-dimensional base. And as I said, it is not going to be a general definition because, so what does mean, why we have two words? Focus it and compactified. I use the word compactified. Now let me go to slides. I use the word compactified so when we make such a correspondence, let me draw this picture again. We have two types of the boundary of the support. We can say on the schema which where the support is constructed. This part of the boundary and this part of the boundary, which is over the boundary here. And we use the word compactified to this part of the picture, which is complement to the boundary in the schema. So compactified framework correspondence will be called compactified even if it is correspondence from the schema with empty boundary. Compactified means that it has this part of the compactification. And it is essential because we work not only, so the generalization is not only formally the consideration of compactified correspondences, but the generalization is consideration of the dimension of framework correspondences. And for the dimension of framework correspondences, it is important to have a compactification in this sense. Otherwise, you cannot generalize the notion of finiteness of the super. To be finite means being projective. And so this is a definition which is okay, and it is implicitly, technically, we can say that it was used in previous proofs. But it was never formulated, and okay, maybe in the article about the rigidity, there is some also notion of the dimensional framework correspondence, or possibly with another name, but and it is used for similar purposes. And this part of the compactification is called focusing, just to separate, just to distinguish. And in the text, we consider this part of the compactification only for schemas which are smooth over local one-dimensional, and consequently the boundary is smooth divisor. And because of this, it doesn't provide the category. As I said, we have already this definition for with some modifications for non one-dimensional case, and we could say that this provides some category, but it is used in another work, which I don't discuss, and for another purposes. And also, there is even a version for the correct definition of the framing. And again, it is not needed for this aim. For this aim, it is enough to have this the shortest way to make a proof. It is to use the definition which is written. And so now I think possibly you understand why I didn't want to present it, because it is rather an instrument in the proof. It is not yet something which I have to share to say that we can use this in directly how it is written to make a category of compactified correspondence.
Can you say what is the assumption on over this, I mean, over the closed point, over this boundary? I mean, you say here that you have a correspondence, a very common correspondence over the generic point, right? And
yes.
What about
and so
this?
the property is that it's projective and equidimensional. For example, if it will be zero dimensional, then it will be finite, surjective, finite.
Okay, I see. So support just the closure of support is
projective and equidimensional.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, equidimensional. Okay.
Yes, and this is a key point. Thank you for the question. Yes, and I assume
that. So if the guy is finite, then you ask that it is. I mean, it remains to be finite over.
Yes, we need the definition finally to get a framed correspondence, and we need finally to have a finite correspondence.
And okay, so you basically ask some kind of a good reduction for, in some sense, right? For from the generic point to the closed point.
Yes, we can say, I will prefer to say that we use a closed fiber to control the information. When we prove, for example, injectivity theorem for local essentially smooth schema, we can use it, it is inside the schema. Here we need somehow to continue the data to this point and to formulate the properties of this data here, because it is the point where we can control. So when we can focus the information to make some conclusions and to formulate some conditions which would provide on opposite side the required properties on the complement to the boundary. In this point, it is concentrated, and we need to have the data to describe it at this point. Yes, the properties finally are that over the closed point, we have something finite. And
thanks.
So this is a standard reason, but the only so what is important that we need to so it is not over this point, it is not a framed correspondence. So if we forget that it is boundary and say take that X is now underlying schema, and if we don't mention that it is boundary, the data will not define framed correspondence from X. We need to formulate another properties here, but finiteness, it is a key property again by which we conclude that correspondence is finite. So thank you for the question. I'm sorry for, yes, and thank you that you are asking. And please continue.
Excuse me, one more small question. So what about smoothness? So
Smoothness of the supports is not a standard property for framed correspondences. They are finite, but not smooth. And here we start in our sequence of steps, we work with d-dimensional and again equidimensional, but non-smooth. Which smoothness is important for us? Let me mention that in these arguments, it was used that this boundary is smooth to reduce the consideration to the one-dimensional base schema. If we have a local schema with smooth divisor, then we can say that it is schema of one-dimensional base. And let me possibly comment that in the another talk, which was made already before, where there were presented some announcements of results on Poussin complex over the generic fiber, for example, of local essentially smooth schema, we do such a scene and for a high dimensional base. In this article, this assumption is not included, and this uses such a, we can say, framed correspondence for over local base schema of finite and arbitrary dimension. And
I understand correctly, so the base is smooth, but
no, base is an arbitrary. This schema, so form, okay. What? Why in the text we use it some smoothness? We are given with U, we are given with smooth divisor D. Then there exists a morphism into some one-dimensional base B. It is not matter is it regular or non-regular, or smooth or non-smooth. In our case, it is in fact projective line and infinity point. A local schema of projective line at infinity point and divisor is in infinite point. In fact, this schema plays a role of the base. But it is not so essential if at the beginning we are given this schema U. I'm sorry, let me add again a slide because this is important discussion. If we are given with some schema U and we are given again with smooth divisor, then we can put it in the included into the diagram where this is regular local schema, namely local schema over, I prefer to say projective line, but since it is local, it does not matter which point. But in the argument, it appears as projective line over field with infinite point. And we consider such a picture. Yes, we can not mention that it is projective line. We can say that it is an arbitrary base schema B, one dimensional. And we can prove the result for apply this to any I explain why the results which we
prove. Okay, I think I understand. Yeah.
Okay. So, and let me also mention that we proved the injectivity theorem, we can say, for this schema at a generic point. And so to prove the injectivity theorem for such a pair where D is smooth, we use it that it can be included in this picture. And then we met this, we applied this technique of compactified focused frame at responses. If it is non-smooth, then we can.
Yeah, this is interesting. This injectivity is interesting because recently Roman Fedorov also proved something.
Yes. I seen this on your seminar. So yes, I agree. It is connected. So we can say that this is such a it's one stable and yes, moreover, P1 stable analog of Misnevich conjecture. Because it is smooth schema, this complement
to
smooth.
What is the reference for this point? Because maybe I would like to know. Well, maybe to mention.
Sorry. Reference to which point?
This injectivity in which of your.
Oh, we can say that it is the main content of the article. The proof of this injectivity. It is the most complicated point in the article to prove such statement for quasi-stable frame at radiative A1 invariant shift.
Okay, can you give me a reference? Let's say on in the archive version, can I see it?
There is a general statement about the Cousin complex in the introduction. And again, it is proven like in original Vygotsky's argument with the use of trigonometric invariance. Firstly, we prove trigonometric invariance, then the injectivity is here it is more general because you see that injectivity is the first term. And concretely the injectivity is this is moving lemma for the injectivity. It is proposition 7.20 and conclusion that cohomologies are trivial on the generic fiber.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, I see. Okay, thanks.
Mm-hmm. Let me mention that it is important in this proposition to prove the injectivity as I formulated. It would be enough to use, I think, the first point here. But here is the second point. And it is, we can say that to prove the first point, it will be much easier. It will not require, in fact, to consider compactified gametopies. It will be enough to work with focusing, with compactification of local schema. But another tool in the proof is work with compactified gametopies. And this second point is, I can say, the key for the proof of trigonometric invariance. It would not be needed to prove the injectivity. Yes, the injectivity is already provided. And this additional property, yes, this is what I were going to explain because this is the main point in the proof. So now let me continue. And okay, this slide explains comparing of the original argument and our argument. So let me outline the proof of stoichiometric invariance. We consider separately cohomologies at infinity, namely, it is complement to the neighborhood of the infinite point to the infinite divisor. And separately cohomologies, we call this out of infinity. It is morally closer to cohomologies with finite super. And to prove triviality of these two parts, for this part, we make a moving, like in classical reasoning, we can say over a fine line, over a field, or over a local schema. So along the line, this schema plays as a base. And for other part, as we discussed and explained it, we use the compactification. Also, we use the frame of correspondences where projective line plays a role as of a base schema. So we make a moving in this direction. And we make here injectivity argument, we can say, but it is essential to control. So to prove the injectivity, it will be enough to control now this part of the boundary again. But we need to control the part of the boundary which is here, which is because of the compactification, we can say, of schema X, and control them simultaneously. And I will explain later why. So this injectivity theorem is strong injectivity. It says that there is a gamotopy such that certain closed subschema along the frame of correspondence goes into the preimage is finite. Okay, in comparing with the classical argument, why we do by this way? In the classical argument, we can say that the obstruction runs in this direction along these lines to the center of the projection. The argument worked with the projection from a fine line to X, and the minimal compactification for this, it is such a corner where this point is non-smooth. And the obstruction is hidden in this non-smooth point. The argument, we can say, do not distinguish smooth and non-smooth compactification. And in this argument, we look and focus our attention on this neighborhood of, and we use smooth compactification. And we look accurately how it looks around the infinite point. The part of the argument, now, this is written now what was said, that there is a theorem about cohomologies out of infinity and cohomologies at infinity. And I use that notation to write this. It is the only change is the zero. Okay, in other terms, it equivalently means that cohomologies are trivial for positive, and cohomologies, zero cohomologies, equals to the presheaf. And to combine these two formulas to write in short, I use this symbol of bar, and I think that in the text, it is underlined, sorry. Just to combine these two forms. So we can say that this is just notation. We can say that this is like if we would compute for Czech complex cohomologies, where the term of the schema, which is lower schema in the power n, is included in the complex. So it differs from the original definition only that there is a minus one term. It is kernel of the canonical morphism from the presheaf into the sheafication and co-kernel. So it is just a notational comment. It is not essential. And let me just to shortify the formulas to use this and write all these four. Okay, then we say what means precisely cohomologies at infinity and out, and cohomologies at infinity, it is just cohomologies on the neighborhood of the infinite point, we have only one essential for us infinite point. We don't need to use a general notion of cohomologies at infinity, defined recently by the Zublot, Deglis, and Astwire, if I pronounce it all synonyms correctly. And for cohomologies out of infinity, we make such a formal definition that this is injective limit of, we can say, cohomologies or over, we define cohomologies over such a pair. We consider category of smooth schemes over X, and we equip it with Nisnevich topology, which is called Nisnevich topology over such a pair. And it means that for any covering, there is a lifting of this open subscheme. So topology is trivial here. On this scheme, topology is trivial. And this is a point of topology. And we take now injective limit for all complements to the finite subschemes. And this is notation above. And this is called out of infinity. You see that it is not the same as exactly as cohomologies with finite support. And it is easy, in fact, to compute such cohomologies. It is easier than to, I think, to compute cohomologies with finite support. So we can say that it is the strongest subtopology such that this schema is point of the topology. Yes, this is the same, but shorter. Again, I have a double copy of this slide and one is not deleted. Yes, now this is an explanation for the proof that cohomologies out of infinity are trivial. And this is general formulation for open subschema in a fine line. And let me skip the discussion of this part because it is based on the principles which were used in the original proof. Namely, we make induction like in the reasoning for relative affine line over a field, using the fact that over a local Gensserian schema, the support splits into the components, connected components. And we make induction by the number of components with the use of excision isomorphisms, like in the proof for relative affine line over a field. And the excision isomorphism, it is only one, in fact, which we need to prove to make the statement because it wasn't proven before. And nevertheless, the argument was used before for a particular case of a closed subscheme, which is zero section, in the article about GW correspondences and in the article about core A correspondences. Let me indicate that in the article for Fermat correspondences, this is different argument for the excision isomorphism on relative affine line around the zero section. And I didn't check would it allow to prove such a general statement, but the argument, another argument which was used for Grandi-Crete correspondences can be applied to prove the general fact, which we need here. And so we can say that this part of the argument, cohomologies out of infinity, can be proven by the techniques which were developed earlier for affine line over. And this is Mudin. So this schema plays as has a role of a base schema for this correspondences. All the correspondences are correspondences in the category of this base schema. And for another part, as we said already, the correspondences are correspondences over the projective line, but compactified and focused. And this is an argument. How do we prove that cohomologies at infinity are trivial? We prove this by some gamotopy injectivity, as was discussed. We make a gamotopy such that one section is canonical morphism and another passes through, decomposes into morphisms through cohomologies on the complement to the closed subscheme Z. and consequently it is zero morphism. You see that in this formula we use stoichiometric invariants, aren't it? But we also, and we have at this moment finite support stoichiometric invariants, or we can say such an out of infinity stoichiometric invariance theorem. This theorem, which can be formulated in general, let me write this, that there is such an A1 invariance for finite support union with, and here is notation for Nisnevich topology given by base changes of Nisnevich covariance on the schema X. Let me check what is the notation. Yes, it is this. So we consider Nisnevich covariance of the schema X, not on the category of smooth schema over X, but we take base changes of Nisnevich covers of the schema X and generate the topology. And then this is equivalent. This allows us to reduce the question to the case of local Gensian schema. And this can be written as the gamma-top invariance. Okay, I can write at the right side. Instead of this notation, I can write at the right side cohomologies on XHZ with the use of the A1 invariance of the presheaf F. So I said that this theorem implied this, and this is a form of the statement of the stoichiometric invariant statement, which can be obtained by, we can say, original arguments. Some parts should be recovered, for example, transfers for cohomologies for this type of cohomologies for such topologies. This part should be recovered, I mean, reproven. And next, we have already this part out of infinity part, we can say, of finite support part of stoichiometric invariance theorem, and we can apply it to prove the triviality of cohomologies at infinity. So what we need? We need to construct such a gamma-topy such that preimage of Z is finite to apply this finite support theorem.
Andrei, you have run out of time, so...
So, okay, yes, let me...
You can say something very short, but right.
Okay, so yes, and I think that it is now almost ending point of the proof. This is rewritten with notations and for the topologies accurately. Because here I mean it, I use this just subscript Z, and here is what are in fact the topologies which we work. And okay, let me indicate that in this argument we use we control the gamma-topy over 3 points 0, 1, and infinity. Usually, so in distinct to gamma-topies which controls only 0 and 1 point, we need to control infinity point. Because of this, we assume that the base field have at least 3 elements. We use the deduction from infinite fields to finite fields to cover the case of field with 2 elements. Now here is, maybe 2 minutes just to formulate what we had got. For now, there is a context. Now, compactifications became it. There are even 2 studies where compactifications and compactified gamma-topies, which are called now box gamma-topies, became it a concept to construct a category to study box invariant presheaves, which are more general than general class than A1 invariant presheaves. And in this setting, there is a question on the trigonometric invariance. And let us formulate the statements which are provided, which can, well, geometrical constructions of our proof can be applied to prove these cases of trigonometric invariance. So, namely, triviality of cohomologies for local schema with local Hessian schema with X with empty boundary, and triviality of cohomologies, we can say with finite supers or out of infinity for both cases for local schema and smooth endpoint in that is smooth point of the boundary. In this setting, let me indicate there are two, in these two different studies, there are two different notions of different generalizations of Nisnevich topology. There is a strict Nisnevich topology and bigger one dividing Nisnevich topology for study of log schemas, and there is just Nisnevich topology for modular pairs. And here we mean strict Nisnevich topology or Nisnevich topology respectively for these cases. And let me, okay, one, just two slides more. Let me explain why, what is essential in our constructions, which makes it being applicable for box gamma-topic context. That one point is that all the correspondences, we can say, are equipped with complexification. And in these studies, it is currently for core correspondences, and we have complexification of the support in our constructions. So it gives a complexified core correspondence. And another point which is essential for modular pairs context, if it respects the multiplicities of the boundary, is that all our gamma-topies are linear. It is given by linear combinations along the variable which is a parameter of the gamma-topy. And this is essential because it should be so to get a morphism in this category. It is so the morphism depends not only on where open subschema and closed subschema goes to, but what is the multiplicity. So the degree of the polynomials which define gamma-topy is essential. And the final comment is that yes, the result is proven for a one context, but in some sense with by the proof of the statement for box gamma-topies. And why it happened that we were needing to prove the statement in fact in hidden form for box gamma-topies to cover a one gamma-topy case. There is such a remark with the oral reference to Suslin that to Vyvodsky that he said that there are even some doubts that study of a one gamma-topy categories should be similar to the properties of these categories and technically should be similar to so for finite characteristic case in comparison with zero, because in finite characteristic case, a one is not one contractible, one connective. And it is some question, why do we contract non-one connective object? And yes, we've seen that to the statement is true nevertheless. It is not breaking. The trigonometric invariance holds in general, but we use to prove this the object which is actually one connective. It is complexified affine line because such a covers of affine line are not etale over the infinite point in the projective line. And there is no etale such a covers of finite covers of projective line. Okay, this is, sorry, I was over time and I finished. Thank you very much.